O Lord, show thy mercy upon us,
and grant us thy salvation.
O Lord, hear my prayer,
and let thy cry come unto thee.
O Lord, be with you,
and with thy spirit.
Let us pray. O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, Everlasting God, we beseech thee to hear us, and vouchsafe to send thy holy angel from heaven to guard and cherish, protect and visit, and evermore defend all who assemble in this place through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
O Lord, the altar of God,
even unto God, my children, gladness.
Descend with me, O God, and defend my cause against the ungodly people, who deliver me from the deceitful and wicked men.
Thou art the God of my strength. Why hast thou put me from thee? And why do I so heavily while the enemy oppresses me?
O send out thy light and thy truth, that they may lead me, and bring me to thy holy hill and to thy dwelling.
That I may go unto the altar of God, even unto the God of my joy and gladness, and upon the heart will I give thanks unto thee, O God, my God.
Why art thou so heavy, O my soul, and why art thou so disquieted within me?
Look on thy trust in God, for I may give thee thanks, which is done for my countenance and my God.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end.
Go unto the altar of God.
Even unto the God of my joy and gladness.
Our help is in the name of the Lord,
who hath made heaven and earth.
I confess to Almighty God, the Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, the Blessed Michael, the Archangel, the Blessed John Baptist, to the holy apostles Peter and Paul, all the saints, and thee, my brethren, that I have sinned exceedingly in thought, word, and deed, by my own most grievous fault. Wherefore I beg Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, Blessed Michael the Archangel, Blessed John Baptist, the holy apostles Peter and Paul, all the angels and saints, and thee, my brethren, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
May Almighty God have mercy upon thee, forgive thee thy sins, and bring thee to everlasting life.
Amen.
I confess to Almighty God, to Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, to Blessed Michael the Archangel, to Blessed John Baptist, to the holy apostles Peter and Paul, to all the saints, and to thee, Father, that I have sinned exceedingly in thought, word, and deed, by my fault, by my own most grievous fault. Wherefore I beg, Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, Blessed Michael, the Archangel, Blessed John the Baptist, the holy apostles Peter and Paul, all the angels and saints, and thee, Father, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
Almighty God, have mercy upon me, forgive me thy sins, and bring me to everlasting life.
Amen.
Almighty and merciful Lord, grant unto us pardon, absolution, and remission of our sins.
Amen.
For thou not turn again and quicken us, O God,
that thy people may rejoice in thee.
Show us thy mercy, O Lord,
and grant us thy salvation.
Lord, hear my prayer,
and let thy cry come unto thee.
Great is the
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts be open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ saith. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. Second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.
Rest yourselves under the tree. may refresh yourselves, and after that you may pass on, since you have come to your servants. So they said, do as you have said. And Abraham hastened unto the tent to Sarah and said, make ready quickly 3 measures of fine meal, knead them, and make cakes. And Abraham ran to the herd and took a calf, tender and good, and gave it to the servant, who hastened to prepare it. Then he took curds and milk and the calf which he had prepared and set it before them. And he stood by them under the tree while they ate. They said to him, where is Sarah, your wife? And he said, she is in the tent. The Lord said, I will surely return to you in the spring, and Sarah, your wife, will have a son. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Be thou my strong rock and house of defense, that thou mayest save me. In thee, O Lord, have I put my trust. Let me never be put to confusion.
Reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Colossians. Brethren, now I rejoice in my sufferings for your sake, and in my flesh I complete which is lacking in Christ's afflictions, for the sake of his body, that is the church, of which I became a minister according to the divine office, which was given to me for you, to make the word of God fully known, the mystery hidden for ages and generations, but now made manifest to his saints. To them God chose to make known how great among the Gentiles are the riches of the glory of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Him we proclaim, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man mature in Christ. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I rejoice in my sufferings for your sakes. May the words of my mouth, the meditation of all of our hearts, be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
I rejoice in my sufferings. rejoicing in sufferings. That's the Holy Spirit speaking through St. Paul. And he speaks through saints that we may have them for our examples. And he talks about rejoicing in sufferings. It's kind of interesting to look at him saying that and to look at the history of our one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church and understand this whole idea of rejoicing in sufferings. And before I get into that, this is not a homily of specificities of, oh, if this happens this, or if this happens that. I want to address the concept of suffering for our own sakes and for the sake of others, because that is part and parcel of your faith. It is truly unfortunate that recently a lot of things have become very man-centered as far as our religion goes. It was not that way up to very recently in the grand scheme of things. Everything was centered upon God. Everything was centered upon our Lord Jesus Christ. Everything was centered upon the sufferings that hit, and then what we did in union with him as far as sufferings go. And when I talk about sufferings, I don't mean the high-end dying and getting very sick and getting injured kind of things. I'm talking about the everyday annoyance kind of things, which are sufferings. The gospel today. Martha, she's all bent out of shape. Lord, my sister's not doing anything. I'm doing everything. Come on, Lord. What does Jesus do? Martha, you're troubled about many things. She's chosen the better part. She's listened to what I've got to say. Now, let's just all go about our business. Going about our business, and our business is, unfortunately, I can't stand up here very rarely can I say, always, never. This is always going to happen. This will never happen. Check this one out. This is one of those few times. Unless you are an infant, you have suffered in some way, shape, or form in this world. And I do mean the high-end things. Most people in here have suffered the loss of a loved one. Many people in here have suffered some tremendous physical problems. Everybody in here, if you've been real lucky and avoided all that other stuff I just mentioned, you at least endure the day-to-day mundane sufferings, the annoyances of life. They are all sufferings, every single one of them. From dying, which guess what? We're all going to do that one, should the Lord tarry, to this everyday annoyance stuff. Kids, jobs, parents, depends on which side of the fence you're sitting on that one. Everything, little annoyances. They are for our benefit if you apply them correctly. That's the concept I want to talk about today. And not only are we supposed to, deal with them. No, the Holy Spirit says, rejoice. St. Paul said, I rejoice in my sufferings. I rejoice in the annoyances. And this is coming from St. Paul. What has St. Paul suffered? Being stoned till when they thought he was dead and they left him. He's been beaten, shipwrecked 3 times. He's got all kind of stuff going. And he says, I rejoice in that stuff. Not to mention the just average everyday people not doing what he says, people turning their backs on him, all this kind of stuff. He rejoices in those sufferings for your sake, speaking to the Colossians. He says after he talks about rejoicing in sufferings, he starts to lay the foundation for the concept. He says, in my flesh I complete what is lacking in Christ's afflictions. Did you pay attention to that? In my flesh, I complete what is lacking in Christ's affliction. What? How's it? Jesus is perfect. Everything that Jesus ever did was perfect. There's nothing lacking in what Jesus, Paul's not talking about what Jesus did. Paul is talking about what he is doing and what he expects from us. When he says, I complete what is lacking in Christ's afflictions, that is actually the best translation of that as far as the concept goes is the Jerusalem Bible, not the New Jerusalem Bible. The New Jerusalem Bible is problematic, to say the least. The old one, just the straight up Jerusalem Bible, which you can still get a copy of that, I would suggest it. It translates it this way. In my flesh, I complete all that has still to be undergone. Let's not walk away from this thinking that for one moment that Jesus hasn't undergone everything that is necessary for our salvation. He absolutely did. Perfectly. Nothing else needs to be added to the sacrifice of our Lord Jesus Christ. But his objective sacrifice was for the sins of every soul that has ever existed, exists, or will ever exist on the face of this planet. Everyone. For the sins of the whole world. So, if he died for the sins of the whole world and everything's perfect, how come, contrary to what you hear all the time anymore, contrary to what our Lord says, how come our Lord says some things like, many are called, but few are chosen? How come our Lord says, many will come to me in that day saying, Lord, Lord, and I will say, I never knew you? If you use Jesus stats, more people are going to hell than going to heaven, which, as I said, is a stark contrast to where you hear nowadays, and you know, they even questioned if there is such a thing as hell, because God would never put anybody there. Contrary to what Jesus says. All right? His sacrifice was perfect for the whole world. So why are people going to hell? Because they don't apply his sacrifice to their lives. They don't embrace him in faith and obedience. They don't go to the Father through him. That's why. It's about application of that perfect sacrifice of Christ. That's what Paul is talking about. Paul is talking about us applying that to our own lives and to others. It cannot be. You know, we love to talk about Jesus Christ, the head of the church. He's the head of the church. You cannot, it's inconceivable that the head could suffer alone and not the body. I mean, that doesn't even fly in our lives day to day. The head suffering and not the body. Oh, I got a real bad headache, but I think I'm going to go and do this and do that instead of, you got a bad headache, what do? You drag your whole body to bed and you lay down. All right? If the head suffers, the body's going to suffer. It's ridiculous to think it's any other way. That's what Paul's talking about. We love to hear about sharing in Christ's glory. Everybody loves that part. If you're going to share in his glory, you're going to share in his sufferings. Because that's why he got his glory. Because of his passion, death, and resurrection. Same with us. That's how we're going to get it. Our suffering, death, and ultimate resurrection in Christ Jesus. If you expect to share in his glory, you must expect to share in his sufferings. That is the striving that we have to endure for our faith. Your faith is not an easy believism. Your faith is not, I go to Mass on Sunday morning and then whatever until next Sunday morning. It's a striving for your faith. I don't want to listen to this stuff. I want to feel good when I leave from church. I want to hear about suffering. This is actually a manifestation of God's love for us. It's actually a tremendous manifestation of our intimate relationship with our Lord Jesus Christ. We love to hear about the union that we have with our Lord Jesus Christ. This is where it comes to the fore. This is where it becomes real, our union with him. If he suffered, we must suffer. We should just contemplate his sufferings and be brought low. We should appreciate so much his sufferings for us. I mean, it shouldn't be a foreign concept for us. Even in this world, we share the sufferings of those who are close to us. Husband, wives, parents, kids, very good friends. Can you imagine husband sitting at the nose in the computer in a newspaper or something, and the wife comes in, "I lost my job today." "Yeah, whatever." "But, huh? Yeah. My mom died." "Yeah, okay." "What? No, you share in their sufferings. It's a no-brainer." See how far that would go if you approached a marriage like that. You know, parents and kids. You know, I celebrate Mass at Nemours Children's Hospital. Oh man, that must be horrible. Those little kids, they're so sick. You know, I actually thought that when I started going down there. And you're around the little kids, and yeah, they are very sick. They deal with it. Their parents are basket cases. And rightfully so. The parents suffer more than the kids. Our union with our spouse or our kids is not as close as it should be with us and our Lord Jesus Christ. So if we suffer for people in this world, when our hearts are broken because something happens to our spouse or to one of our kids, how much more should our heart break when we consider what our Lord has done for us and what he expects us to continue to do for him? It's the theological argument, as St. Thomas Aquinas and St. Alphonsus Liguori talk about, the objective sacrifice versus the subjective sacrifice. Christ died for our sins. He died to establish the reign of the kingdom of God in this world. And when we understand that he did that, he did it objectively and perfectly. The subjective sacrifice is what we do in association with that. When I use the term subjective, I don't mean what your opinion is about it. I mean, how do you apply it to your life? How do you engage with the sufferings of our Lord Jesus Christ? The application for both our own wants and needs and for those of others. That's what St. Paul's talking about in this reading right here. Yeah, when you suffer, you do good things for yourself. Because we learn a whole lot more through when we're uncomfortable than we do when things are comfortable. That's just the way it is. That's just our makeup. We don't have a tendency to learn well when everything's going right. Because when everything's going right, we take everything for granted. It's those times when things get bad. And like I said, run the gamut. Day-to-day nonsense, humiliations, whatever. If we associate those and apply those things, they are for the expiation of our sins in this world. Christ died for my sins. Yes, he did. Now he expects you to apply that sacrifice to yourselves. St. Paul says in that reading, if we didn't remember, he has now reconciled by his death in order to present you holy and blameless. We all love that part. We all love that part about being reconciled by Christ's death, and he's going to present us holy and blameless. We would love in our humanity to throw a period at the end of that and just leave it at that. It goes on. He says, provided that you continue in the faith. Provided you continue in the faith. And our faith is a faith that has always taught us that we must put ourselves out for our Lord Jesus Christ. That we do indeed need to suffer. Like I said, let's jump tracks from that real bad stuff that we always like to talk about. Dying and getting sick. Think about the other thing. The mundane things. The things that happen all the time. When we apply those things, those little annoyances, if we apply them correctly, we are expiating little by little those things that we continue to do in this life. Our faith is a faith where, guess what? Not only are you supposed to deal with life's little this, that, and the other thing, you're actually supposed to bring it on yourself. That's where we get words and ideas like fasting, where we get ideas of like corporal works of mercy, corporal penances. Well, we don't do that anymore. Yeah, it's quite obvious. You should. You're supposed to. Don't fall in that trap. We are supposed to engage in the sufferings of Christ. And guess what? When God doesn't think you're engaging enough in the sufferings of Christ, he'll let you have some that you didn't expect. We have a tendency to suffer for Christ as long as it's within our comfort parameters. Yeah, I give this up and I give that up. Well, every now and then he's going to dump on you. Every now and then it might just be a little tug of the rug where you just kind of lose your balance for a second. Other times he's going to jack that thing right out from under you. You're going to fall flat on your face because that's when you learn best. St. Paul uses the analogy of military stuff in sports a lot to talk about our faith. A good sport for this, but you go to the weight room, you go to the gym, you can lift weights all day, and then there's that last part, or the last part of the workout where you're just supposed to strain and your partner's sitting there, come on, get it up, and you can't get it up. And you're straining and all the blood vessels are bursting up, and he helps you up a little bit. That last little part does better for you than the whole rest of the day. That last little part, when you put forth that effort, that last little effort is those bad sufferings. The whole rest of the workout is the average, everyday stuff. That is for you when you apply it to yourself. When you associate those things with the sacrifice of our Lord Jesus Christ, he will bring you closer to him. And let's not be selfish about this. It's also for others. Hence the first line that we read today, now I rejoice in my sufferings for your sake. You know, it was the Apostle Paul who was beaten. It was the Apostle Paul who was stoned. And he said he rejoices in that stuff for your sakes. Because when you see how he suffered, it will teach you to suffer appropriately when things happen to you, whether they be small or great sufferings. As I said before, Jesus Christ suffered and died to establish the reign of God in this world, and he did it perfectly. And then he did something. He established his church. He instituted his body in this world, which is the church. So he suffered and died to establish the reign of God, and he still does. He's up in heaven making intercession for us, but he expects us to carry on his work. And what was his work? Suffering and dying for others. He expects us to do the same thing. St. John Paul II says, speaking of suffering, it is suffering more than anything else which clears the way for the grace which transforms human souls. That's why a whole lot of souls are not being transformed in our day and age. They're not being transformed because they're told that they shouldn't have to suffer anything. When the faith, when our religion becomes centered on man as opposed to God, or even, well, it's not centered on man, there's still God there, we're just bringing man up a little bit. We shouldn't. We should know our place before our Lord Jesus Christ. We should know that we need him. We should know that we are supposed to suffer for him. We should know our relation, where we stand with him. I was sitting here yesterday up in my office, and I'm working on this, and I was like, okay, how do I tie this all up in? You know, I want to make this point about how we need to know who we are before God, that we're not too good to suffer, because if he suffered for us, then we must suffer. But a lot of people don't know that in this day and age. And I was sitting at my desk trying to figure out how an example or an illustration to use this. And my desk is here, and Mr. McCain, our seminarian's desk, is over there. I hadn't even mentioned a word to it. It's how the Holy Spirit works. He gets up and he goes, hey, you got to hear this. He does that just to annoy me on occasion, as which many of our parishioners do. They send me emails and stuff about things going on just to annoy me. He come walking into the office. He says, "You got to read this one. This is great." And he starts reading me this. It was a letter that some woman wrote to some Catholic publication. And obviously she's Catholic in name only. Never opened the Bible before, but she's Catholic in some way, shape, or form. She wouldn't have written this. Her deal was that the Pope, this was addressed to the Pope needs to do this. He needs to take out the most disgusting part of the Mass. Because if he took out this one part, this disgusting part of the Mass, then everything would be okay in the world. And the part of the Mass was when we say, "Lord, I am not worthy." That's horrendous, according to Christine. Christine, who has obviously never opened this Bible, Christine, who doesn't care that she looks stupid in front of everybody who ever has, you know, she's going to publicly proclaim, that's not very charitable. No, but true. Truth trumps charity. If you're charitable to people, you will tell them the truth. And she said something stupid. She's bad-mouthing, "Lord, I am not worthy." You know, you would think that she would have opened the Bible at least and gone to that, or maybe she probably doesn't even know it comes from the Bible. I just conjecture on that part. I always say when I conjecture. You would think that she would open the Bible and go to the part where it says, "Lord, I am not worthy," and see what's going on. That's a Gentile centurion, a Gentile soldier who wants our Lord Jesus Christ to heal his servant. And the Lord says, "Fine. I'll come heal your servant. Lord, I'm not worthy that you come under my roof. Say the word only and my servant will be healed." Jesus Christ does not respond, "Go, what's wrong with you? You're pathetic." If you have that mentality, then if you have that, if you're that self-denigrating, then you're going to denigrate others, and that's why the world's going to be a problem. You are worthy of me coming in your... No, that's not the response of our Lord. Our Lord looks at him, and actually he looks at his apostles and goes, "I have not found such faith in Israel. This guy gets it. He's not worthy that I come under his roof." Christine doesn't get that. Christine thinks that she's okay. Christine doesn't need to suffer. Christine doesn't need to have her pride shaken in any way, shape, or form. That's Christine's problem. And guess what? Our churches are packed full of Christines. Want to come here, hear something nice, bolt. Preferably before anybody else leaves. Because then you get caught up in traffic. All right? Our churches are full of people like that. They don't get it. Because when you get that, when you get the fact that you are not worthy for him to come under your roof, when you get that, then you start to understand the fact that you need to strive and engage in your faith. You need to engage with his sufferings. The only way you can do that is suffering yourself. No matter what it is, high end or low end. We need to be able to say the words that St. Paul says at the end of that reading today. And that is that it is Jesus Christ that we proclaim, warning every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man mature in Christ. For this I toil, striving with all energy which he mightily inspires within me. If you are close, or if you are where you should be in your relationship with Christ, he should inspire you. And what does he inspire according to the Holy Spirit? He inspires you to toil and strive. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God, begotten not made, being in one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men, for our salvation, came down from heaven, and was incarnate.
proceed from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spake by the prophets, that I believe one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I acknowledge my baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Let us pray for the whole state of Christ's church in the world.
Almighty, never living God, who in thy holy word has taught us to make prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all men, receive these our prayers which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord, and grant that all those who do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word, live in unity and godly love. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to Francis our Pope, Stephen our Bishop, His Holiness Benedict XVI, to John the Bishop of Orlando, and to all bishops and other sacred ministers, that they may both, by their life and doctrine, set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. And to all thy people give thy heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here present, that with me heart and due reverence, they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serve thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. We beseech thee also so to rule the hearts of those who bear the authority of government in this and every land, that they may be led to wise decisions and right actions for the welfare and peace of the world. Open, O Lord, the eyes of all people to behold thy gracious hand in all thy works, rejoicing in thy whole creation, they may honor thee with their substance and be faithful stewards of thy bounty. And we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor all those who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. In this day, especially for Jennifer. And we also bless thy holy name for all thy servants, a part of this life, and thy faith and fear, especially Claude, beseeching thee to be merged from the grand and fullness of joy in thy love and service, and to grant us grace so to follow the good examples of the Blessed Virgin Mary and of all thy saints, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant these our prayers, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our mediator and advocate, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory.
Amen.
Ye that do truly and earnestly repent you of your sins and are in love and charity with your neighbors and intend to lead a new life following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith and make your humble confession to Almighty God, meekly kneeling upon your knees.
Almighty God,
Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed by thought, word, and deed against our divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent, and our heart is sorry for these our misdoings, the remembrance of them that grieves unto us, the burden of them that is intolerable. Have mercy on us, have mercy upon us. For thy Son and our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter preserve and please thee in the newness of life, to the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
May Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, of his great mercy, hath promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him. Have mercy on us. Pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and bring us to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear our comfortable words, our Savior Christ, hath all that truly turn to him. Come unto me, all ye that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, to the end that all that believed in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Here also what St. Paul said, this is a true saying worthy of all men to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Here also what St. John said, if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is a propitiation for our sins. Pray, brethren, that this, my sacrifice and yours, may be acceptable unto God the Father Almighty.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice of thy hands, for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and of all his holy church.
O God, who didst ratify the manifold sacrifices of the law by the one perfect sacrifice of our redemption, mercifully accept the oblation of thy bounden servants, and sanctify them with that benediction wherewith thou didst bless the gift of Abel thy servant, that what each hath offered to the honor of thy majesty may be profitable unto all for their salvation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Up your heart.
We lift them unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God.
It is meet and right so to do.
It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on the first day of the week overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened unto us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, especially this day, Jennifer, and all who here around us stand, whose faith is known unto thee, and their steadfastness manifest, on whose behalf we offer unto thee, or who themselves offer unto thee, the sacrifice of praise, for themselves and for all who are theirs, for the redemption of their souls, for the hope of their health and well-being, and who offer their prayers unto thee, the eternal God, the living and the true. United in one communion, we venerate the memory first of the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, of Blessed Joseph, her spouse, as also the blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Thaddeus, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and of all thy saints, grant that by their merits and prayers we may in all things be defended with the help of thy protection. We beseech thee then, O Lord, graciously to accept this oblation from us, thy servants, and from thy whole family. Order thou our days in thy peace, and bid us to be delivered from eternal damnation, be numbered in the fold of thine elect. Vouchsafe, O God, we beseech thee in all things to make this oblation blessed, approved and accepted,
a perfect and worthy offering, that it may become for us the body and blood of thy dearly beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, who the day before he suffered, took bread into his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes lifted up to heaven unto thee, God his almighty Father, giving thanks to thee, he blessed, broke, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. Likewise, after supper, taking also this goodly chalice into his holy and venerable hands, again giving thanks to thee, he blessed, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. Pure victim, the holy victim, the immaculate victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Thou say to look upon them with a merciful and pleasant countenance, and to accept them, even as thou didst vouchsafe to accept the gifts of thy servant Abel the righteous, and the sacrifice of our patriarch Abraham, and the holy sacrifice, the immaculate victim, which thy high priest Melchizedek offered unto thee. We humbly beseech thee, Almighty God, command these offerings to be brought by the hands of thy holy angel to thine altar on high, in sight of thy divine majesty, that all we who at this partaking of the altar shall receive the most sacred body and blood of thy Son, to be fulfilled with all heavenly benediction and grace. Remember also, O Lord, thy servants and handmaids who have gone before us, sealed with the seal of faith, sleep the sleep of peace. To them, O Lord, and to all that rest in Christ, we beseech thee to grant the abode of refreshing, light, and of peace. To us sinners also, thy servants, who hope in the multitude of thy mercies, thou safe to grant us a part in fellowship with thy holy apostles and martyrs, with John, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicitas, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and with all thy saints, within whose fellowship we beseech thee, admit us not weighing our merit, but granting us forgiveness, through Jesus Christ our Lord, through whom, O Lord, thou dost ever create all these good things, thou sanctify, quicken, bless, and bestow them upon. By whom, and with whom, and in whom, to thee, O Father Almighty, the unity of the Holy Ghost, be all honor and glory throughout all ages, world without end.
Amen.
Let us pray. As our Savior Christ hath commanded and taught us, we are bold to say, from all evils past, present, and to come, and at the intercession of the blessed and glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with thy blessed apostles Peter and Paul, and with Andrew and all thy saints, favorably grant peace in our days, that by the help of thine availing mercy, we may ever both be free from sin and safe from all distress. Regard not our sin, but the faith of thy church, and grant to her that peace and unity according to thy will, who liveth and reigneth with the Father and the Holy Ghost, ever one God, world without end.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And with thy spirit.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him that taketh away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst come under my roof, but speak only, and my soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst come under my roof, but speak only, and my soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst come under my roof, but speak only, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
humbly thank thee and that thou dost feed us in these holy mysteries with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and thus assure us thereby thy favor and goodness towards us, and that we are very members and forward in the mystical body of thy Son, the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs to the hope of thy everlasting kingdom, by the merits of the most precious death and passion of thy dear Son. And we humbly beseech thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship, and do all the good works of thou hast prepared for us to walk in. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, whom we need the Holy Ghost, for your honor and glory, world without end. Amen.
Let us pray. Grant, O Lord, that the power of thy healing may mercifully cleanse us from all our perversities and lead us henceforth in the paths of righteousness through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
The peace of God which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost be amongst you and remain with you always.
Amen.
The Mass is ended. Depart in peace.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
The beginning of the Holy Gospel according to St. John the Divine.
Glory be to thee, O Lord.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men, and the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. There was a man sent from God, whose name was John. The same came for a witness, that bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came into his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth.
Thanks be to God.